Hi, everybody. This is Lou McNally, and tonight on Made in Maine, businesses whose superior craftsmanship and unique designs have brought them worldwide recognition. We'll be in Camden to visit Moss Incorporated. For over 15 years, they've specialized in tent design, concentrating on producing the highest quality shelter. I'll be at Priscilla Turner Rugs in Lewiston. The carpets that they manufacture are the focal point in homes and offices both in and out of the United States. And we'll take you to Rockland, where Weather End Estate Furniture is made. Now, this company uses boat building techniques to create a product that's enjoyed by world famous people. Stay tuned, won't you, for Made in Maine.
Made in Maine is a production of WCBB Channel 10. Major funding for Made in Maine has been provided through a grant from the Maine Department of Economic and Community Development, working in partnership with communities and businesses to achieve balanced growth for Maine's future. Additional support is provided by People's Heritage Bank, banking for families and businesses at 39 banking centers located throughout Maine.
Moss Tent's experience with tensioned fabric technology, which they developed, and the possibilities of increased strength and space at a lesser weight fuels their drive to create new standards in lightweight shelter. Fran Shea shows us more from Camden.
The advantages of tents have been known for thousands of years. Tents combine the romantic and the practical. They are versatile, portable, economical, and associated with freedom and excitement. However, the traditional designs and materials used for construction limited what you could do with tents. That is, until Bill and Marilyn Moss began making them. With new technology and an awareness of the structural possibilities of curves and tension, Bill Moss's tents combined artistic design and functional practicality. Today, Marilyn Moss Rockefeller runs the business. Bill Moss is a major shareholder, and although no longer employed by the company, his innovative designs are the basis for all of Moss Incorporated's tents.
Bill, being an artist, he really did look first at how something looked. He wanted it to be top design, to be a beautiful shape, a piece of sculpture. His belief was that function would follow form, and it does, and that's been true in every single product that we have. We started out doing backpacking tents, manufacturing and marketing backpacking tents. I started with only one or two dealers. I used the old trick of the puppy dog, where I would just call and ask dealers throughout the country if they would take one of our tents and set it up in the showroom, and they could return if it didn't sell. And of course, most of them did sell, and that's the way I established the dealer program. When I started the company with Bill, I knew nothing about manufacturing or business. I had had some business training or background, but certainly not anything to be able to really handle this kind of project. So I had to really make mistakes, and I made a lot of them. And from that, I started learning and started asking people and expertise that I didn't have, and going to seminars, and I established over 235 dealers with the backpacking. Our company still was not profitable. It's very difficult being a high-end tent, and our margins are still quite slender. I had to make a decision at that time to either go overseas and manufacture there, so that we could be a little more competitive with $100 less in a tent, which a lot of our competitors have done, or stay here. And we did check out a number of companies, Taiwan and Korea. I had a number of tents made. but I was very dissatisfied with the quality, and that was the one thing that Moss had really created in the marketplace, was a name for itself in quality and service. So we started getting these sample tents back, and they just didn't meet our standards, so made the decision, all right, we can't do that. What are we going to do? So I studied the market of exhibits, and this was a huge marketplace. It was $2.8 billion and growing, and there was no one else in there doing tension fabric exhibitry. So we actually started a whole new market segment using the same technology that we had in our backpacking tents, the same machinery, the same people, the same construction, the same materials. So it was just natural for this company, and it's the way we've turned the company back to being profitable.
The work that we do is very much hands-on. In other words, we work a lot with the very materials at full scale that we're going to be using in the structures. The normal process that you probably imagine would go on is we'd start with a drawing or an idea, and then we'd pass it on to production and they'd build it for us. Well, that is really not the way it works. In fact, we often go out and mock up at full scale the very structures that we are going to be developing, testing the fabric, testing the tubing, which we often use aluminum tubing, testing all the various materials together. In addition to that, we work with a variety of scales of study models and working models along the way, and that helps us with the patterning, helps us get an idea what it's going to look like, and helps us make some of the mistakes at small scale so they're not so costly mistakes when they get blown up really large.
One of the things that we do for quality control is a pre-check of our fabrics, and we're looking for fabric flaws, coating streaks, line flaws that would show up from time to time. We also test for the waterproofness of the material ahead of time so that there are not problems that are found after the tents are produced.
Moss Incorporated is so sure of its products that they offer a lifetime guarantee on all their tents. If an original owner experiences any defect in the framework or workmanship, the tent will be repaired or replaced, free of charge, for the life of the tent.
In order to provide this guarantee, we set up each and every tent that we produce here at Moss, which I think is an extremely unique production arrangement in any company. And we feel very proud about that fact that we can offer this lifetime guarantee.
Our sales are $1.8 million, and that is about 50% in backpacking and 50% in exhibitry, except we do have another market in architectural canopies that is a small percentage of our business for backyards and commercial restaurants using canopies to extend their either their living space or their eating space. Our aspirations in the company are to really reach a 5 million level, and I believe we can do that in the exhibit marketplace. I think in backpacking, just virtually the fact that we have a high end tent and the backpacking market just isn't what it used to be, we can't really rely too heavily on that. But I think with the exhibits, we'll be able to reach that and attain that. And naturally, we'll have to come out with new products to be able to do that. And we'll probably have a new product at least every other year, if not every year.
This is a new product which we've introduced to the trade show industry. It's a 10-foot inline booth. It's fabric. It's what really makes the product is this system which we've developed, that's a set of accessories that goes with the system. And I'd like to demonstrate to you or explain to you what these accessories are. First of all, as part of the package, we include a very lightweight table which is made of the same type of system, an aluminum framework covered with fabric. As well, here's the back wall, you can see with Velcro incorporated into the seams, which is allows you an easy way to attach graphics to the board, large or small. Then we have a shelf system which also Velcros onto the wall very easily. It's very lightweight, very simple to carry around. You can see it breaks in half. Supporting the shelves are two cupboards, which also you can use to store your brochures or coats and hats, whatever you have in the booth. There's a header that can be silk screened on and backlit. As well, we have a lighting system, which is a fluorescent light that washes the wall from either side, and spotlights which hook into a track system that give you specific lighting. Also, what's important about this is that everything about the system snaps on, the header, the lighting, comes off and on very easily, so you don't have to screw or bolt anything together. It's very easy to take apart and set up. Yeah, and right over there is an example of what it looks like completely taken apart, and that's the package that you would receive.
The one thing about coming to work is that it's really an exciting and beautiful product. There are good days and bad days in any small business, as I'm sure any small business person would attest to, but it's just such a beautiful product, and the fact that it's non-polluting and really gives people pleasure and adds to recreation, and the exhibits creating a real need in a marketplace that was there and no one else was fulfilling, just makes me feel very proud and as though we're really accomplishing something with the design.
Moss tents are marketed in the United States and in Japan and Germany and Switzerland. And it's entirely possible that you might find an example of a Priscilla Turner rug in any one of those and many other countries. We're here in Lewiston today at Priscilla Turner Rugs, where they're actually made. And the process begins back in the design room there. And from there, the design is transferred by paper onto the rug backing here. Let's have the expert explain it. Phil Dare is here. He's the sales manager.
Hello.
Phil, how are you today?
Fine.
Thanks for having us by. Could you tell us just what's going on here?
Sure, Lou. Right here we're printing a rug pattern on primary rug backing. The pattern is the brown paper that you can see there, and it's been prepared in the art department, perforated with tiny little holes so that our specially concocted ink transfers the pattern onto the backing. Now, once the cotton is dried and the pattern is fixed, we'll take the cotton off the nails and we'll transfer it over to our hooking department, either our vertical or our horizontal departments that you can see down here.
Over here, right. And here all the activity going on. Now, the horizontal, now this is where they're actually applying the yarn.
That's right. The yarn's actually inserted into the backing. You can see the horizontal section in the foreground here.
Yeah.
Further down, we make considerably larger rugs in the vertical section.
Let's take a look down there.
Sure, let's go.
All righty. Is this a different process down there?
Yeah, it's a little bit different. The machines vary a little bit, and the techniques are a little different.
It appears that these people have to have some kind of skill to do this.
Well, that's right, Lou. It takes about a year to train a hooker. They really have to be good production workers, but they also have to think about what they're doing and put a lot of themselves into the project, because each one of these rugs is special, and that's really what makes it work.
Have to be kind of a craftsman and a skilled worker at the same time.
Exactly, exactly.
Well, now we've got, what, a smaller version here, a small rug?
Well, that's kind of right, Lou. This is a sample frame where we make a small section of a rug to get the customer's approval for the large rug. You can see Tom here.
Oh, he's matching the pattern there. That's the fabric.
Exactly. We've taken the fabric and we're trying to place the colors into the carpet to try to get the feel of the fabric. We'll send that down to the customer and get their approval. They give us the okay and we'll go ahead and make the rug.
Now, is this how you get an approval sample made from fabric?
Or wallpaper, or in this case here, you can see a painted picture or rendering.
Is that like from an interior designer?
That's right. It's from a design firm. Design house, actually, this one in New York City. Here's the sample, and you can see we replicated it, matched the colors, and they okayed it, and we made the rug and shipped it in this case, and they were very well pleased.
So our process here is the vertical hooking, and then from there it goes...
That's right. Once the yarn's completely inserted here and everything's been inspected and up to snuff, we'll bring it over this way, inspect it some more, and then we'll put on an adhesive backing, cotton mesh scrim, and hem it up and ship it.
And then from there it goes out all over the world, I understand.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Thanks a lot for having us by today, Phil.
It's a pleasure.
Appreciate it very much.
Thanks for being here.
The folks at Priscilla Turner are indeed proud of their product. I'm going to go down and take a look at this right here. Before I do, I want to tell you that the folks at Weather End Estate Furniture are also very proud of the fact that their products were in place at the centennial celebration for the Statue of Liberty in 1986. And Linda Endy will show us more from Rockland.
Looking to a bygone era for elegance and quality, and incorporating the latest advances in boat building technology has proved to be the right combination for Weather End Estate Furniture in Rockland. Sales of the company's line of outdoor furniture is expected to reach between $2 and $3 million this year.
Well, Weather End, I think, both as a company and as a product, has a very unique place in the marketplace. One of the reasons I joined the firm was because of that unusualness. If someone is wanting to buy a piece of upholstered furniture, as an example, there is a very wide variety of upholstered furniture available in all kinds of price ranges. So all of the various market niches that one would think of about upholstered furniture seem already to be filled. But if one wants to buy wooden furniture of very high quality for outside, we are it. So we have a rather unusual and unique market niche in that we provide very high quality product in a rather unusual industry.
The Weather End collection is based on the designs of a Norwegian-born landscape architect, Hans Heisted. Heisted came to Maine in 1910 to design the grounds for several of the summer cottages the nation's wealthy were building on the coast. One such commission was the Weather End Estate in Rockport. Hans and his crew spent 4 years transforming the rocky, barren land into a series of outdoor rooms. Wooden furniture was designed to complement the curves of the stone walls. In constructing the furniture, Heisted used the boat building techniques he learned as a young man. More than a half century later, the furniture was still in place. Weather End Estate Furniture was founded in 1984 by Bill Fisher. Fisher served as the company's president until his death from a boating accident in 1987.
Bill, who was my employer at that time, had just graduated from Colby College and had an idea of photographing the pieces that were on the estate at Weather End, and decided after these shots of the furniture came out that it would be fun to try and market this furniture. So he ran an ad in Garden Design and Landscape Architecture to see what sort of response there would be. It was kind of a marketing exploration for him, and he had an interest to see where the furniture could go, if anywhere, with it. And surprisingly enough to himself as well, the furniture received all sorts of responses from people in the design profession, as well as inquiries from people who wanted to have that look in their backyard. So that's when I was employed or began working for Bill, and it kind of took off from there.
The prototypes for the new company were made by a skilled boat builder. Using Heisted's designs as a model, modifications were made in construction to incorporate the latest in boat building technology. The furniture was also adapted to make it more comfortable, such as scooping the seat bottoms and angling the backs of the chairs. The aesthetic beauty and versatility of the pieces has made Weather End a favorite among interior designers and architects. The furniture can be found in a wide variety of environments, from residential properties to office buildings, shopping malls, and at Rockefeller Center in New York City. Due to the nature of the finish, graffiti washes right off. The company is continually adding to their line. They now produce pieces specifically for indoor use. These pieces are made with the same materials and construction techniques as is all their products. For the sake of efficiency, Weatherend has made some changes in their manufacturing process over the years. Whereas the first orders were made by one master craftsman, the company now employs a production staff of 35 people. The production process is based on a ready-to-assemble inventory using interchangeable components. This contrasts with their previous method of making each piece as the order came in. The stockpile of interchangeable components speeds up the delivery time considerably.
We build approximately 2,500 pieces a year. Not a great volume of furniture for a production shop, being that our process is so involved in making sure that the best of everything is there, the best materials, the best methodology, and the best people, and to give the best product. So the process is a lot more involved than a normal a production shop would be.
Two types of quality hardwoods are used by Weatherend. Teak, which has long been associated with the shipbuilding trade, is used for the unfinished pieces due to its durability in an outdoor environment. The finished pieces are made with Honduras mahogany. The wood's close grain provides an excellent surface for the paint to adhere to, and it also has excellent bending properties needed for the curved components. The curved components are made by a lamination process. This is a fairly new boat building technique used in hull construction, whereby many plies of wood are glued together with a marine grade epoxy, resulting in an extremely strong component.
An example is the rocker for the rocking chair. Many rockers are one piece of wood, have a tendency to check and split over time. Our rocker is several laminations, a very strong part that will never give the customer problems with checking or breaking or warping or cracking. And that's the same with many of the structural pieces in the curved parts of our furniture. They're all laminated rather than a solid piece of wood that can check and move and a part that's hard to maintain a tolerance for as well. We stay away from staples, pins, dowels, a lot of types of joinery that's used in furniture that just is not sufficient in an outdoor environment. We stay with a mortise and tenon joint that has a very good tolerance. We get 100% glue contact in that joint. And we have a nice machine that does these tenons that gives additional benefits. One important one is that it will cut a groove at the base of the tenon. This allows the glue to perform a locking action in the joint itself when it's put together. So we end up with a super joint, a joint that's stronger than the wood itself.
The furniture is designed for maximum drainage. Many extra measures are taken in the assembly process to ensure a long-lasting product. These measures include coating all joints with epoxy and pre-finishing all contact areas. The finish process is a long and important series of steps, since the high-gloss paint will show the slightest flaw. Each piece gets four coats of a sealer, then is hand-sanded and inspected, at which time four coats of a primer are applied. At this point, the pieces are both hand-sanded and machine-sanded to achieve a very fine surface. After a meticulous inspection, the pieces are ready for the final four top coats.
The primer, sealer, and the top coat are all urethane products, which are very durable products, the best that can possibly be used in an outdoor situation. The product is normally used on everything from President Bush's Sikorsky helicopter to the American Cup yachting vessels.
The labor-intensive manufacturing process, as well as the high-quality materials used, makes Weatherend Estate Furniture a rather expensive product. This set sells for about $9,000. High prices notwithstanding, the company continues to grow.
We think there will always be room in the market for high quality. We have high quality automobiles, we have high quality luggage, we have high quality clothes. There will always be room for high quality. People appreciate that. And we believe there's room for high quality in this industry. And as a result, we do everything possible in our manufacturing process and the design process as well to make the very highest quality we know how to. I think that's counter to the trend in manufacturing today. Most people are trying to make something to fit a particular market that is defined by making it less expensive. How can we make it less expensive? How can we take value out of it? What we try to do is to put value into it in order to make it the very best. And we believe that there will always be a segment of the market that will want the very best, and we'd like to fill that requirement.
There's a strong connection with Maine at Weatherend, with her boat builders and with the great estate, and each of the pieces is named for an island in Penobscot Bay. Perhaps their continued success will mean tapping the Calendar Islands in Casco Bay too. We're closing in on the end of the process here of making custom rugs at Priscilla Turner. We're also coming to the close of the show. Hope you enjoyed it this week, and hope you'll join us again next time for another edition of Made in Maine.
Major funding for Made in Maine has been provided through a grant from the Maine Department of Economic and Community Development, working in partnership with communities and businesses to achieve balanced growth for Maine's future. Additional support is provided by People's Heritage Bank, banking for families and businesses at 39 banking centers located throughout Maine.